I think, T, if you disagree, take it a different direction. I personally think the more interesting angle from last night is this sudden new direction the Bills are taking, rather than how well the Chiefs ran the ball. That's interesting because that's different.
Yeah.
But I think it's the Bills. But if you want to go with Kansas City, take me there, wherever you want.
Yeah, no, look, with Kansas City, and I think it's interesting, but it's a brief conversation. They ran the ball 46 times, BT, which is not something that they never do. Not just this Kansas City Chiefs iteration of Andy Reid's offenses. It goes back to when he was in Philadelphia. Just not what he does. But, you know, doing a lot of college games, BT, I can see and notice the simplicity of defenses, and it's literally one of two things. You're either playing cover one or you're playing, you know, it's a shell with cover two, so you're playing zone, and the safeties are way deep, and, you know, it's easy because they do so many run-pass options. You're always seeing runs, right? It's why you see so many runs in college, because you get these big shells. They don't want to give up these big plays, and so the safeties play deep, and, you know, they want to be the deepest team on the field, which in turn causes the offense to turn around, hand the ball off to a running back. And the same thing applies in the NFL. It's just the coverages are much more complex, except when you play the Kansas City Chiefs, because they are such a big play threat. Like everyone, whether it's Watkins or Tyreek Hill or Travis Kelce, they're big play opportunities almost every play if you don't play a shell. So teams are just, the Bills said, look, we got to play a shell. And as a result, the Kansas City Chiefs just turned around and handed it off until they stopped it, which they never did.
Yeah.
It's simple. It's not complicated why they did that.
No, I'm with you. And listen, you know, before we got off the air yesterday, we were joking around. I'm like, hey, you probably want to lay those 5.5. I loved Kansas City. Mm-hmm. And the reason I love them, I mean, aside from that, you know, the point spread, but the reason why I really love Kansas City, the Bills suddenly have this huge hole in the, maybe I shouldn't say suddenly, but they have this huge hole in the middle of their defense, their linebackers, the entire core has been withered away. And compromised here, and you know, maybe, you know, I'll say their name, maybe the Jets just weren't able to expose it early, maybe the Dolphins, who didn't look great the first couple of games, and they played them in week two, so they started Jets, Miami, they played some weaker teams, and I think that is partially attributable to this sudden hole in the middle of their defense. It's now being exposed by quality teams, but also you're starting to see some regression from Josh Allen. And to me, that's the big takeaway. Like, I think that this is probably a pretty fair assertion. What matters now is what happens after the statement. Mm-hmm. But for me right now, I think it's fair to say that Josh Allen is not, he's not as good as the player that, you know, we were touting the first four games. MVP, and I don't mean like on the periphery. You know, we're talking like, you know, number one or number two. He's right. He was right there. He's not there anymore after two average to below games. But he was... In reality, he's not quite that player yet, and he's not the shaky, inaccurate. Well, he could be inaccurate because that's been an issue, but he's better than what he's played the last two games. So what's paramount for the Bills is that gets corrected very quickly. They're able to mask up that middle portion of the defense and hang on for dear life. But I will say, and I take no pleasure saying this because I picked the Bills to win the division, mm-hmm. and I think that they probably still hang on and get it done, but I have now modified my expectations for the Bills. What I thought they might be able to accomplish this year, I don't quite feel the same way.
Yeah, well, I mean, and it's hard to point to what's causing this. So he had a decent day, you know, for most of this season. Decent days, I mean, completion percentage versus touchdowns versus, you know, interceptions. The Tennessee game where he threw two interceptions, that was a bad one.
Oh, one was a tip. That first one was a tip, to be fair. But yeah, I got you.
I'm just talking about statistically, just like his impact on the game. And then when you look last night, it was the first game in a long time where he put his feet to work. Right, the first game of the season, remember this, against the team that you don't talk about, that I do, the New York Jets. He had 14 carries, right? And he just was dominating. He scored a rushing touchdown. It was almost like, how can you defend against him if he's going to throw the ball this well and he has this ability to run, as we've seen over the entirety of his career, right? And then all of a sudden, that started to pull back. It pulled back specifically against Tennessee. And then last night, while he had eight rushes, it was almost by necessity. It wasn't like it was part of the game plan. It wasn't, you know, we're gonna use Josh Allen's skill set as a runner to set up other things. And it was more, uh-oh, something's broken down.
See, I actually thought that it was part of the game plan to keep Kansas City off the field.
Yeah.
Like, those felt like design runs to me the first few.
Some of them, yeah, the first few did. But then once it got away from them and, you know, they I don't know if they panicked. It was almost like he was put into a position where, because they shouldn't have panicked. The game wasn't that far out of hand.
No.
It felt like they got put in a position where Josh Allen is now having to be Mr. Comeback King. And he hasn't done that, you know what I mean? So not as just a pure passer, and it put him in a position where they just look bad. Now let's be real. And Kansas City had a bad game a couple weeks ago, but they have a really good defense. And when they get after you
like it more than I do.
I do. Well,
you like it more than I do. I don't love it.
I'll give you this, BT. They're inconsistent, mm-hmm. but when they're on, they're really good. And they had a sound and a tight game plan. And the Bills couldn't figure it out. Now maybe that had a lot to do with the weather, you know, with the rain and the, you know, you couldn't air it out as easily, and the field is slippery, and you just worry, you know, about, you know, making mistakes in weather like that. But I looked at that game and said this Kansas City Chiefs defense is playing their butts off, and Josh Allen didn't know how to deal with it.
Yeah, I just. You know, and what is that line of delineation between, you know, playing great defensively or playing pretty good defensively mm-hmm. against an offense that's not going to slice you up? You know, I don't know. Singletary's nothing special. We know that. That's why I really thought they should have made a – well, I guess they did. But Le'Veon Bell chose Kansas City, who obviously couldn't play last night. He'll play next game. They need something on offense. And, you know, that was Diggs with the sick catch, right?
Yeah.
Which was a great throw, by the side, way.
Yeah, like on the corner of the end zone.
I don't know how we squeezed it in there. Yeah. I don't know how we caught it. I don't know how he dotted the I's with his toes. But I feel like the Bills are morphing – I felt like there was an element of dynamic play the first month of the season that was fun to watch and encouraging.
Big plays.
Now I feel like they're morphing back into pedestrian offense that they've kind of been for the last 20 years. I'm not saying that they can't self-correct and still have pockets where they hang 35 on you, and Josh is going to connect some big balls downfield because he's got a great arm, mm-hmm. and he's got some players. Brown could play. Diggs could obviously play. I know that. But, again, I just need to throttle back, dial down the enthusiasm for this team. And if they force me to ratchet it back up, I happily will.
Yeah.
I love watching the Bills play. I really do.
Well, they've,
but right now, I'm dialing it back a little bit.
Yeah, look, they've lost to two really good teams. The Tennessee Titans, as we know, they're undefeated. They're really good. So there's no shame in getting blown out. But it was surprising that they got blown out as bad as they did. That was 42-16.
Dougly.
Yeah. I mean, but it was surprising. But we know that Tennessee is good. So they're just
but we think that Buffalo's good. So eventually, if you're good, you got to be the good team.
Yeah, but it's so early in the season. Like the first quarter of the season. I mean, they played the Jets in
Miami. October 20th.
I know, but we're only six games in. There's 10 to go, right? There's 10 more games to go.
Hey, I can't wait for those over for my team's
yeah,
point.
Yeah, right?
Just get over.
But think about it. There's 10 more games to go. And so they played well in some of these games, but when they played the elite, they're not the elite yet.
No.
Right? The Buffalo Bills. And I think we probably wanted to elevate them there because we know, or at least we think we know, they're going to win the division. And so when you're winning divisions and you can beat the Pats, you can beat obviously the Jets and Miami. You feel like, man, you're in the elite class, but you can be a division winner, maybe win 8, 9, or 10 games and still not be anywhere close to elite.
Correct.
And so I think that's the disconnect from what we thought and what we're now finding out.
But it's not only what we thought, it's also what we were exposed to the first month of the season. Like,
true.
It felt like they, all right, so they make the playoffs last year, they come back this year, Josh Allen goes from this to this. Like, whoa. You have to throw him in the MVP race, which we did happily. You know, we're touting him, we're saying, geez, I mean, we've never really, I mean, really, we talked about how we've never seen, you know, such palpable growth, like in an area of obvious deficiency, which was throwing the ball with great accuracy.
That's right.
Something he struggled with at Wyoming. Something he was like 52% his rookie year.
Yeah.
Wasn't a ton better last year, especially when it mattered. You know, he went from a very raw but interesting project to seemingly overnight this refined game wrecker.
Yeah.
And it was crazy.
Here's the thing. His career average completion percentage is 58.7%. That's including this year's 61%. So that's including. It's still 58.1%.
Yeah.
The first couple of years, it was,
52%.
It was mid-50s on average the first couple of years. And so this year, 71%, 68%, 72%, 70%, even 63% in that loss to the Tennessee Titans. But more importantly, he was impactful everywhere. Four touchdown passes, two. He's done for two at least every game.
Mm-hmm.
And so you know that his game has evolved. It's just a matter of doing it every outing as opposed to, okay, sometimes you're going to have an off day and you got to find ways to win anyways. When he has his off day like he did last evening,
mm-hmm.
He hasn't figured out how to still find a way to win.
That's fair. I wanted to throw this in there about Mahomes. Well, by the way, Charles Davis, as I said before, coming up next, our colleague here at CBS. So I was watching, and I'm saying, man, he seems pretty. And I didn't know this about Mahomes. Not that mm-hmm. I thought that he wouldn't do this, but it was really cool and eye-opening for me to see it. It's so apparent that he's just all about the wins.
Mm-hmm. Right? Doesn't care at all about a stat.
That's where I'm going.
Yep.
And you never know. Like, when you have, a young player who just burst on the scene, whether it's a big-time scorer in the NBA, wants his shots, whomever it might be. Name a star player that puts up 25 to 30 points a game that gets to jack up 20-plus shots. And now all of a sudden, let's say if there's a modification there and 20 becomes 12, Is there still the same energy and earnestness throughout their career? Maybe. Like with Steph Curry? Probably. With some others like James Harden? I'm not so sure, right? So with Allen Iverson, if AI's taken 12 shots back in the day and that's throttled back from 23, mm-hmm. I don't know if AI is fully embracing that. Maybe I'm wrong, and no disrespect. I love his game, but I don't know if he was built to be able to process that. It's obvious that this young man is, and that's a LeBron quality, that's a Magic Johnson quality, that's a quality that is that's a Tom Brady quality. Yeah. I don't even know if Peyton Manning would have been thrilled handing the ball off that. I think Tom Brady's okay with it. I don't think Peyton would have been too thrilled about it.
No.
Special quality.
Yeah, it was. And again, now 10 of these rushing attempts were Pat Mahomes. They had 46 on the day, but 10 of them were for Pat's himself. But he only attempted 26 passes. But in those 26 passes, he completed 80% of them.
21 of them.
Yep. So, I mean, he's adjustable. And I think that's why he's so valuable to this team. And, certain quarterbacks, you just feel like, all right, they got to do it this way. Otherwise, it's no way. They're not going to be successful. He's multiple. And that's the difference between the last two MVPs. Lamar Jackson, if he's shut down as a runner, we've seen what it does to him. He gets inept at sometimes throwing the football.
Yep.
Whereas Pat Mahomes, sometimes he can be a runner. Not that he wants to do it, religiously and every evening, but he's got some acumen as a ball carrier, as an athlete. We saw it on that one, almost third down completion.
The U-turn.
Yeah, where he's going to run out of bounds. He stopped and did a pivot and then came back in, set up fourth and short. And they went for it and obviously scored a touchdown. Darren Williams scored a touchdown on that. So he can do it all. And it's kind of awesome to watch him, even if he's not putting up these humongous numbers because people are taking it away from him.
Think about Aaron Rodgers and what he projected last year.
Mm-hmm.
Remember when they're, LaFleur's a rookie. Wow, Packers are winning.
Yep.
But, Aaron Rodgers isn't really doing that much. He didn't look thrilled during the process.
No.
He did not look thrilled handing the ball off and throwing for a .180 or .212, certainly pedestrian numbers for anybody, but especially for one of the most talented quarterbacks of all time. It's something that, I always looked at him as a great teammate, but when you're that good throwing the football, you want to throw the football. The fact that he's fully on board and doesn't change what he projects his outward demeanor, whether he's handing it to the guy behind him or he's throwing it 30 yards downfield to whomever, that is great. He is just awesome. And he does put you on skates more than you would think.
Yeah.
He does.
I know. He's sneaky like that.
He is. And I know we'll get with Charles Davis next here, but I'd be remiss if I didn't add, that's the kind of game. I know every fan can say this, but you got to have 60,000 people in that building last
mm-hmm.
night. That place. That those fans, that team, they deserve. You know what? Who knows? Maybe they get a stop on that one of those last third downs.
Yeah.
Maybe they get the ball back. Maybe they have a chance to tie the score. I don't know. But an empty What's the state? I don't even know what it's called. It's not. Is it? It's not Bill's. It used to be Bill Stadium. What is it called now? Whatever the name
is now. Took
New
the name
era.
Off.
Used to be New Era.
I think they took the name off of it.
Is it just Bill Stadium?
I think
now?
It's just Bill Stadium.
I think you're right.
Yeah, because New Era pulled out of the deal
because of
pandemic, the economy.
I don't know if they found a new sponsor, but no. I think you're right. I don't think that they did. Whatever it is, I think you're right. I think it's Bill Stadium. That's a night game, some rain, you're 4-1 coming in, you got Mahomes defending champs. Boy, that's
those Bills maniacs. They would have been there regardless, freezing their ass off.
Oh, yeah.
It would have been
absolutely
awesome.
And loud. Thanks for watching. Make sure you like and subscribe, and don't forget to hit that bell to be notified when we drop fresh content.